be shy, 'cause life won't bring you down too far.
Andrew McCart, IFL TV in association with MTK Global. I'm here at Production Park in Wakefield, Rotherham, Sheffield, wherever I'm, I don't know. But I'm over the moon to be joined by Adam Booth. Adam, it's been a while. You might say, oh, don't be all sentimental and stuff, but I've missed you. I've missed you.
Tell him you shed tears when I walked through the door, didn't you?
I had a wee tear in my eye. I was so happy that I had a big smile on my face anyway, so it's definitely good to see you. Shall we talk some boxing? Yep. Harlem Eubank, what performance? I spoke to him on Monday and he said that he was going to hunt Mark McDonough down. He was going to, and he did that. He was on the front foot. He was forcing the pace of the fight. Landed great shots coming up from the feet with the left hook. I said to him, "Is that something he's been working on in training camp? Has that been something you've been working on with Harlem, as in sitting down in the shots a lot more?"
It's something that Harlem's been working on for a long time. His dedication and application to this sport is as good as I've ever seen. He's learning in the gym with sparring with Josh Kelly, Michael Conlon, and all the guys that come to spar with them, as well as Abbas Barrow. His sparring is so far ahead of where he is. It's that's brought him on. He's fearless. His attitude is second to none. He has got excellent attributes. He didn't show them all tonight. He loaded up a little bit. I think he had hurting him on his mind probably a bit too much. But and also remember, he's been out for a year. Mm-hmm. And he had a hand injury as well. So there's a big performance for him tonight. And I do expect his improvement in the ring to be as drastic as his improvement has been in the gym.
I think we saw that tonight, because that's probably one of the best performance I've seen from Harlem. I've been to a couple of his fights now. I said to him as well, reference the 140-pound division. It's a stacked division. You follow boxing, you're a boxing man. Domestically, you've got guys like Lewis Ritson. You've got Ekeem Innes Brown fighting Philip Boas for the British and Commonwealth. You've got Sam Maxwell. You've got all these guys in the division. Obviously, Jack Carroll, Josh Taylor will be a bit further ahead. But the division, 140-pound division, is an exciting division for Harlem. Now, in this current climate that we're in, we've seen fighters take steps sooner rather than later because of what we're in. Oh, is Harlem ready for that big step up he's only 10 fights in. Is he ready to step in with somebody like the Sam Maxwells, the Lou Ritson, who's a wee bit further on in their career?
Absolutely not. No, he knows that he's improving himself as a fighter. He considers himself a martial artist. But his development has been so rapid in the gym that I can't necessarily predict how fast he's going to move. It's about using fights like tonight as the barometer. His next fight will be equally as important as tonight. There's no rush. He's a young man. He's an impatient young man that wants to make up for lost time. But if he fulfills his potential with his attitude and application, he will get up into that mix. When? It all depends on his progression on fight nights now, because the progression in the gym has been there. He's now got to prove it under the spotlights.
Quick word on Charlie Beats. I mean, he's a quiet man, he doesn't like the camera, but and he's a vet, he's always got a smile on his face, but when it comes to getting the work done, he gets it done. Just a quick word on Charlie.
Not just Charlie, there's Charlie B and Huzaifa Iqbal.
Yeah.
The two guys that...
Yeah, baby!
Those two and me, we're the coaching team. And I'm proud of my team. It's like something I've never had before. The work that Charlie does is so quietly effective, and the things that he's teaching and the things that he's drilling, I walk in, I watch, and it makes me smile inside because I love watching it. I love watching this sport done the right way.
Talking about impatient guys, you said Harlem's a little bit impatient because he wants to. Then I want to talk about a little bit McConlon then. Super bantamweight is the talk now. He's moving down. He was 2 pounds over the weight, I think, or 3 pounds over the weight in his last fight. When can we see... I know Mick's very impatient. I know Jamie tries to rein him in a wee bit for the world title fight and stuff like that. But as a coach and obviously a good friend of Mick now, when can we see him fight for that world title? Can it be this, maybe tail end of this year, beginning of next year at some stage?
Well, that now is all down to MTK and Top Rank to secure the position for him in terms of what he is as a fighter, what he can do, what he understands, and what he's ready for. He's ready for it now. If I had a call tomorrow to say his next fight's for the world title, I'd say absolutely. So he's ready. It now just depends on how the landscape of the business falls in front of Michael.
Definitely. I want to get your thoughts on the heavyweight scene. Did you watch Povetkin versus White the other weekend there? Just what were your thoughts on Povetkin's shot and the fight itself?
It's very entertaining, actually. The fight was more one-sided than I thought it was going to be in terms of Dillian's jab and control at long range. But it just goes to prove that in heavyweight boxing, when you've got someone with a resume like Povetkin, even though he's, 40 years old now?
41, yeah.
41, that he has that power and experience and know-how to set it up. So even when it kind of looked like he was on his last legs, and his legs didn't look good in that fight, his hands still worked, and the jab dip left uppercut had Dillian in a bad position, and that's all. And that's heavyweight boxing.
Can Dillian come again?
Any heavyweight. Listen, one thing I have realised over the last few years is that you can't write off any of the big fellas because they continue to surprise or come back. And so I'm not going to write Dillian off, no. He was winning the fight. He was winning the fight and he got hit with a devastating shot. So he's got to go back. I think for Dillian, the biggest challenge is the mental element now, because he was winning the fight. It's not a technical thing in terms of can he outbox Povetkin. Psychologically, he's got to deal with it immediately, rectify the little positions that he ended up in that gave Povetkin that opportunity, and immediately get back in there with him.
You like to see the immediate rematch, because I've seen his social media that he's already in the gym, he's already back in Portugal, he's training away. He seems to have the right mental state in terms of he's took it on the chin, he's rolled with it and stuff like that. So, well done, mate. He seems to have the right mental state that you're talking about. So, do you think he should jump in with the rematch straight away? I know we've seen it with Joshua and Ruiz, but sometimes coaches advise against that, but you're obviously one for it.
Well, he's an experienced heavyweight. Right? It's not like he was stepping up and lost and has to regroup and figure out where he is. He knows where he's at. He was in a competitive fight that he was winning comfortably and he got caught with a shot. So that's not a scenario to run away from in terms of making the rematch. He just got to deal with the positions he ended up in that gave that opportunity and just deal with the mental aspect of it. But I've known Dillian for a long time. I've known Dillian since he was in the amateurs and when he came to spar with David Hay while he was still an amateur. And he has always had the mindset that he'll get in there and trade with anyone. So I would be absolutely shocked if he just doesn't get straight back in there with him.
Obviously, he was mandatory for that WBC title for 1,000 days or whatever it was. Has that loss brought the Joshua Fury fight closer in your eyes in terms of we might see it now without Dillian, sort of, sorry to say this, but being in the way with that mandatory, could that fight come forward now?
I don't know. Honestly, I don't know, because
do you want to see that fight sooner than later, Joshua and Fury?
It's the one heavyweight fight that needs to be made. That is it. Regardless of anyone else, regardless of Deontay Wilder or Dillian White or any of those guys, the one fight in the heavyweight division that needs to be made for the sake of the sport and for the sake of the two fighters' legacies is Fury against AJ.
Do we have to wait till the crowds are back in for this fight? Because obviously you've witnessed now boxing's been back for a while now, but no crowds and stuff like that. The atmosphere isn't quite there and stuff like that. For me, I would like to see crowds back for the AJ and Fury so the fans can experience that show. But can we have it with no fans, AJ and Fury?
Well, you can, right? I mean, who would have thought 6 or 7 months ago that we would have been in this position where Champions League finals and FA Cups and the Premier League and world title fights would take place in front of no one or in TV studios. We're living in such absurd times, and I just hope that the human race gets itself back together and realises what this is all about and that we're allowed to have crowds back at sporting events.
I echo that. Won't keep much longer, Adam. You probably want to go and celebrate a little bit more with Harlem. But again, I enjoy talking boxing with you. I'm glad that you showed up, like I said. I'll put a smile on my face. Thanks for doing this Fivefold TV, Adam, and go and enjoy the rest of your night with Harlem.
That's fine. Thanks, mate. Cheers.
Thanks very much, Adam. Thank you, bro.
Don't be shy, 'cause I, life won't bring you down too far.